There's a strange thing happening. I don't know where the time goes. I don't remember yesterday, and I don't understand tomorrow anymore. All of this time, just slides past me. I remember him being sick in vivid detail, and I guess that's not unexpected, and I guess it's obvious that I'd remember it all. But it's with me in such clarity, in such granular detail, that life doesn't have now. It's technicolor, all those hours and days. There's something precise and almost comforting the way I think back to that time, that horrible, horrible time that I thought I'd never want to live through again. It's comforting, I guess, because it's the last time I felt that hours and days mattered, that they were differentiated and defined and meant something. And then, out of nowhere, it's coming up to the first anniversary of Russell's death, and I have no idea how we got here. I'm Sophie Townsend, and this is Goodbye to All This, an original podcast from the BBC World Service. Chapter 8. Going Under. In this new life, almost a year after he died, nothing quite adds up, makes sense, not in the way it used to. But it hits me one day that maybe if I could hold on to one thing that happens every day that I could time my life by, that maybe I could get back some control, even just a little bit. And maybe that thing is dinner.
You know, Soph, you were quite evasive for a while there, not answering calls and stuff, and I just thought you were being tough.
So I ring my friend Barbara, Babs.
And then I came over and, you know, we talked about dinner, and you talked about how hard it was to make dinner, but then you'd wave off some of my questions and we'd talk about something else, and then you kept coming back to it.
Before Russell got sick, he'd been in charge of weeknight dinners. He didn't mind the endless negotiation with the girls over what they ate. Didn't mind the pickiness, the lack of gratitude that accompanies cooking for children. I'd cook for dinner parties, show off meals where I could play hostess. He did the real work. This year, the year we've lived without him, I can't remember cooking dinner.
You said you didn't really have much time to cook for the girls, and you worried about relying on takeaways all the time, and you felt guilty about that, and then the guilt made you feel resentful, and that made you feel even less inclined to cook.
I wanted to nurture my girls. I wanted to show them how much I love them, but dinner? Every night? Every night?
So I decided we needed to make a chart. We needed to know what the girls like to eat, and we needed to have a list of recipes that you could do mostly on the weekends, and then during the weeknights you could make just simple things, a balanced diet for them with all the right vitamins and all the food groups, and that would make you feel okay.
Babs likes a chart. She's tidy, organised, efficient. She's not like me at all.
While I was there, I noticed the spider webs. So even though I knew this was wrong, I found a broom and I started to sweep them away. And you did look embarrassed, but I just didn't want you living like Miss Havisham. So I just kept sweeping.
While Babs is there in my kitchen drinking tea, Poppy comes in, asks if she can have a hot chocolate. But there's no milk. There's never any milk, she says, and storms up to her room. And Babs just keeps making her chart. She asks me what the girls like to eat. Hot chocolate, it seems, I say.
They like pasta, chicken, mince. You'd say, I don't really know. And then you'd just sort of look off into the distance.
I don't know what they want to eat. I don't have enough milk in the fridge and I don't know what they like and I really don't know who they are anymore.
Well, it was strange. You just didn't seem to connect with the whole eating thing. They looked fine. They did look healthy. And I was thinking, how long does scurvy take to kick in? Neither of them would answer any of my questions about what they wanted to eat either. It was like the three of you were surviving on air.
It takes Babs all morning, but she gets a list together, sketches out a system. She takes her notes saying she'll type them up and send them to me.
There were a lot of papers around in the house and I wasn't about to leave you with another one.
She can't help herself. She cleans a smudge off the kitchen cupboard, rinses some glasses and puts them away. She tells me I should get those paintings I've got resting against the fireplace in the living room, hung up on the walls. She does these things without judgment. But when she's gone, I look round the house and think how badly it needs a proper clean. I think about starting with the vacuuming and wonder about dusting the mantelpiece. I could do that this afternoon. The weekend stretches out before me and it's not as if I have anything else to do. But I don't get out the vacuum cleaner. I sit still and the day draws on. My mind wanders and I think about cooking spaghetti bolognese for dinner and I think about taking Poppy to the supermarket because I know she misses doing that with her dad. I think about spending time with Bear, getting her to help me cook. I could teach her to chop onions. I think about all these things and how much I love my girls, but also how hesitant I am with them now. How frightened I feel to mother them without Russell here to father them. And the afternoon wears on and I have a nap and run out of time. I go to the corner shop to buy milk, just as it's closing, and I pick up a frozen pizza for us to eat for dinner. And so I don't cook or clean or go shopping. I book us a holiday instead. Russell grew up in a place called Mwilumbah. It's a little town inland from the north coast of New South Wales, on the border with Queensland. It's about a 9-hour drive up the highway. When you grow up in Mwilumbah, you go surfing at Byron Bay. Byron's an old whaling town, taken over by hippies in the 70s, replaced in the 90s by cashed-up holidaymakers who demanded proper coffee and something other than veggie burgers to eat. Going to Byron was the first holiday he and I took together. Driving up that highway, visiting his aunts, dotted along the coast, for a cup of tea and a chat along the way. We went up north, up to Byron every couple of years. We buckled the girls into their car seats, took a break halfway up the coast to stay in a motel in Port Macquarie. We still visited the aunts, who fussed over the girls, and talked to Russell about ancient triumphs and tragedies as if they'd happened last week. There were grudges to go over, family histories to be dissected. And so, on the day of the anniversary of his death, we go to Byron. And I don't make a big deal of the day, the girls know, but I don't want them to think this is a pilgrimage where we have to behave and think in a certain way. I think about taking his ashes to scatter in the sea, but I don't know if I want them so far away from us. So I leave them behind in the plastic container we got from the undertakers. This is just a break. A break in the routine of our life without him. Perhaps that first anniversary, I should have made a big deal. Perhaps there was some ritual we should have performed or something I should have said. But you can't light a candle in a car and you need to keep your eyes on the road, so you've got to avoid tears. So I said nothing much at all. We wind our way up the coast like we used to. We break the trip at Port Macquarie the way we always did. But we don't visit the aunts, because I don't know what to say. It's such a long drive, and I miss the stories he used to tell, and I miss the music he always brought to listen to in the car, because I've forgotten to bring any of the CDs we like. So there are long stretches of highway we struggle to get radio reception on, and the girls are bored and they argue and I yell, trying not to feel too bad, because this road has never been easy. And they have always fought. And Russell or I, or both, always yelled. And just as I begin to think that we should have got a flight up and saved ourselves the long drive that never ends, we see the sign to Byron. And the girls cheer, and then we come into town. We find our lodgings, go out, get a pizza for dinner, then collapse into bed. The air is warm and the country is green. We visit the lighthouse and we play in the surf and have fish and chips for lunch. When Russell was alive, the first thing we always did was go to the big supermarket just outside town to get supplies. But this is such a short visit. I don't want to waste time. We can get takeaways, eat out. We're on holiday. I look for the shop where they read your tarot and sell tie-dye bikinis that always fall apart in the surf, the colours running into the sea. But it's closed, replaced by a corporate surf shop with logos and proper labels and sizes. I tell the girls it's a sign of the times. It's not the hippie town it once was. Now it's full of highly paid medical specialists visiting from Melbourne. We laze about for a couple of days, the girls occasionally arguing about something trivial. Me getting cross. We pass the supermarket on the day we decide the weather's no good for the beach and go inland to visit the rainforest. I wonder if I should buy supplies, but don't. We get home and I check my emails. Babs has sent her chart and I read it and it makes me want to cry. It's so well laid out and makes things look doable. So why aren't I doing it? We go out for dinner. At the holiday apartment we've rented, Bear and Poppy share a room, but Poppy comes into mine each night. She tells me her sister is talking in her sleep or snoring or coughing. I don't think she's doing any of these things, but Poppy wants to be near me, and that's okay. She wakes me early one morning and says, I don't get how someone can be there one day and then they're gone for the rest of your life. I just don't get it. I tell her I don't get it either. I'm going to be 10 this year, she says. It's my birthday very soon. It's 2 months away, I say. That's still pretty close, she insists, like it's not a year away or anything. A year. She's been thinking of her life measured out in years. Measured out in years like this one. She falls back asleep. There are plenty of beaches to choose from in Byron. On our last morning, we head out early, park the car and walk over the Watergoes Park to the little arc of beach that's always been my favourite. The girls prefer the main beach with its bigger and more exciting surf, but I insist today, on our last day, that they indulge me. The sky is grey with clouds and the rain will come, but it's warm this morning. And if we're only to have one more swim, well, it's my turn to have it at this place, where their dad and I stayed on our first trip up here together. I'm blasé about Watergoes because it's always been safe. I tell Bear it's the beach she paddled at as a one-year-old, all fat cheeks and legs playing in the shallows. Today we wade in. The water's warm and we swim easily through the waves. The girls are good swimmers, old enough for me not to watch over them every moment. But when I dive under a wave, I know I can't catch. By the time I bob up, they're much further from me than I'd like. And then I feel it. A strong, narrow channel of water running across the lines of the breaking waves, like a river running out to sea. A rip current. And I didn't notice until it was too late, because here at Watergoes, the water's always calm. But not today. The sky seems darker now as the water swirls us further from the safety of the sand. It's okay, I yell, don't panic. Mama, shouts Bear, Mama, I can't get to you. In a rip, you need to swim parallel to the beach. Everything in you tells you to get back to shore, but there's no way you can get through it. The water's moving too fast in the other direction. Don't try to get back in, don't fight the rip, I yell out. But it's hard to heed my own advice because we're moving towards the rocks. They're sharp and jagged and I'm frightened of getting thrown up against them. Just keep paddling towards me, keep coming this way, I tell them. I'm not strong enough to hold both of them and Poppy reaches me first. She's gulping at the air, swallowing water. I just have to keep yelling across the water to Bear to stay calm, keep her arms up, and someone will help us. I see a man coming towards her, but I can't tell if he's coming to help or if he's struggling too. And before I know it, Poppy and I are swept against the rocks. I try to keep my body between her and the edge and look for a way I can hold her up high enough to get her on the rock shelf so she can scamper across the sand. She asked me what we do now, and I don't know. I look back, and I can't see Bear anymore, and I can't let Poppy go, and I'm stuck between these girls, just me and them. I don't know how long we're in the water in this panic. It's probably not even 10 minutes, but it's unmeasurable in this state where everything stands still and speeds up all at once. A man, strong and confident, comes and gets Poppy and I. And I yell to him that my other girl is somewhere, and I don't know where. But he says it's okay and takes us to the beach. And we're spluttering and shivering, and there's Bear. There she is. Safe. She looks at me, still frightened, and I look at the man who saved us all and say, thank you, thank you. No worries, he says, no worries at all. I want to tell him that in fact it's a very big worry, because these two girls are all I have. But I can't, because after a quick goodbye, he's off to catch some waves. We watch him for a while on his board. And Poppy tells us the story of what she is now referring to as our near-death experience, as her sister rolls her eyes and tells her not to be so dramatic. They squabble over how close they came to drowning here at Watergoes Beach. And I say, could you be quiet? Could you just give me a break? They do. We drive back towards the holiday rental. But before we reach it, we duck into the supermarket. On my phone, I look at Babs's chart and I follow it. I follow it because Babs is always worth following. And because there's nothing else to do. Babs is a widow too. The first widow I ever knew, apart from my grandma. I'd watched her at his funeral and wondered how she did it. Then I'd watched her move through the world and had no idea how fragile she was. Because you never do. When Russell got sick, she never offered me advice. Never presumed my story was like her story and that I should do what she said. When he died, she never predicted what I'd feel or told me she knew what it was like. We're different people, her and I, and things happen differently for us. A simple chart with words like chicken, bolognese, noodles. That's what she gave me instead. 1,000 times more useful, it turns out. I buy groceries for a simple dinner, which I cook on the stove that's inadequate, in pans that are ancient and too small. And the girls complain that they don't like it as much as pizza, and I just shrug. And with my glass of wine, and with their glasses of juice, I propose a toast. To their dad, who we all miss so much, and to them, who have lived through a year now with me, and who helped me more than they know, and who I love more than anything. Bear tells me to hurry it up, dinner's getting cold. Poppy asks exactly how much of dinner she has to eat before I'll let them eat ice cream for dessert. She's not impressed by the answer. For the first time in a long time, I feel like their mother again. I feel like we're a family. Such a simple thing, cooking dinner. But it's made everything all right. As I sit watching them, it feels like I've fixed things. And I have, for now. The problem is, of course, they don't stay fixed. Me and the girls are pulled under the waves of grief again and again. And I have to work and work at keeping our heads above water. So somewhere along the line, I start to wonder if there's anyone out there who might come rescue me. And where it is, I might find him. Goodbye to All This is produced by me, Sophie Townsend, and Eleanor McDowell. The music has been specially created for the podcast by Jeremy Wormsley. Alan Hall is the executive producer. The consultant story editor from CBC Podcasts is Chris Oak. The BBC World Service podcast editor is John Minnell. It's a Falling Tree production for the BBC World Service.